Blog Talk Radio.
Welcome everybody to Morris Talk Live 100. I'm your host, Tarhaka Amana L. Bay, and tonight we're dealing with part two, the first peoples on the lands of the Americas, and we'll also be discussing the illusion of time. My special guest will be Joi, Pearls of Joi, okay? We'll be dealing with the following subjects. What is time? How did my ancient ancestors tell time? What vibrational frequency should we be using? How should we tell time? What does nature have to say about us in time? Where are we headed as a nation of people today? How are we supposed to count? What is an hour? What is a minute? What are seconds? What's all of that about? Well, nevertheless, we're going to get down in that. And my special guests, when they get in, they'll press one on the phone, and that'll give me an indication that they're ready to ready to roll. And but in the meantime, I have something I want to talk with y'all about before we get started here. I think a lot of people have been paying attention. Now, in my opinion, it's just my personal opinion, we live in a country of boxes. Now, when I say that, what I'm saying to you, because I'm a builder and I'm a carpenter and I build frame houses, form and finish and all of that stuff. But if you notice that the buildings and houses that everybody's doing across this country and other places around the world, it's always a square foundation. Now, that square got four corners. The corners on the square is a 90-degree angle. Now, when you multiply 4 times 9, then you're going to get you're going to get 36. 6 plus 3 is 9. Okay. Now, what I noticed, what I found very, very interesting today, is just yesterday, I was looking at a tornado come across the land. And this particular land that the tornado was coming across had these houses on that land. And all of those houses were built in a circular motion, all of them. And the tornado came right smack their body, right alongside the houses. And the foundation of the house was circular, the roof on the house was circular. And they had windows in a circular motion all the way around the house. But all of the tornado blew all of the windows out. But what was interesting to me is it didn't take the roof off, it didn't tear the walls down, and I say that's quite extraordinary. The circular building, it was about 3 or 4 of those houses there. But it did not snatch the roof off. I mean, this was like a F3 tornado. That was a powerful tornado. And I noticed that when it comes to, I know y'all seen these things about UFOs, especially on the internet. They designed a circular motion, circular sphere. They're designed that way. And, I'm over here working. Okay, now I'm back. But anyway, we're going to get down in this here tonight. And we're going to deal with time. And when it comes to the Gregorian calendar, keep in mind now, there are 1,440 minutes in a day. There are 86,400 seconds in a day. There are 10,080 minutes in a week. And there are 525,600 minutes in a year. Okay, now this is all mathematics. This all is attached to minutes, seconds, and hours, and this kind of business. But as soon as my guests arrive, then we're going to be discussing this stuff. Okay? So y'all hold on a minute. I'm going to the commercials, and I'll be right back. Y'all just sit still for a minute, okay?
Tarhaka here, y'all. Where were the judges, lawyers, prosecutors, police, et cetera, when she got pregnant with your child? They weren't in the bedroom or in the place where you two were. But now they're up in your business about child support and how much you have to pay and when, where, and why you have to see them about your child. Let's deal with it. go to www.tahakadebtelimination.org. They did me like that one time because I didn't know who I was. But it's a different day now. My contact information is at tahakadebtelimination.org. Let's deal with the child support thing, man. Peace. Hello, everybody. It's me again, Tarhaka. America is experiencing some tough times today, but there's a way out for you. All you have to do is get into the private, live out your days as a secured party and a creditor, instead of living as a debtor. I'll show you how. Visit TarhakaDebtElimination.org. My contact information is there. It has to be tough struggling trying to make ends meet. But as a secure party and creditor, life's a little bit sweeter. All your bill collectors got you listed as a debtor. Let's turn this thing around to TarhakaDebtElimination.org. Peace.
Okay, we're back. Tonight we're going to be here for Mr. Billy Carson. I got a copy of the Emerald Tablet on my desk here. And let's see what else we got here. The Kabbalah Tree, A Journey to the Balance of Growth by Richard Pollack. And we got my guest book. She's an author of a book called The Gift of the Law. Okay. But anyway, we're going to get down in here. And what I'm going to do now is I'm going to deal with something. We want to deal with vibrational frequency today. And to answer that question, in my opinion, we should be resonating at the highest vibrational frequency that we possibly could. And that does require having a certain amount of knowledge, a good attitude, and a proper diet and rest and stuff also contributes to that as well when it comes to the vibrational frequency. And we want to know what frequency are most people resonating on. We want to deal with that as well. But before we go anywhere, we want to deal with our first peoples in the Americas. Okay? So let's go back in time. We're going to let my young man, Kudimayu, come on in and do a little something that while we're waiting on my guest to arrive. So y'all hold your hats, we'll be right back, okay?
Much love and respect. Thanks for tuning in once again. Quick video today, little throwback for the new people and anybody who has forgotten previous videos. I get a lot of comments of Queen Khalifa just being a fictional story, a romance from this Spanish guy in the 1500s. But we have gone over that already. We've proven that her legend is a lot older than just a 1500s romance book. We're going to go over the information again real quick, showing you that this so-called romance was inspired by many legends, centuries old, and by Columbus and the early explorers that were coming to the Americas and going back. with their stories. Again, just want to remind you, we have many videos on Queen Khalifa. We've shown her existence in 1200 AD in Roman law books, showing you the original sources where her story is in there. So it's not a 1500s romance. We also have videos with other primary sources talking about warrior women the early explorers were encountering in South America and the Caribbean. Make sure to check all these videos out. So again, today we're just going to go over briefly where they say they got the story from. And the same author is going to let you know that he got it from earlier accounts, a story that was already centuries old. We're also going to get what Hernan Cortez said. He didn't get it from a romance book. He got it from the American Indians, the story of Queen Khalifa. We're going to get all that right now real quick. So I hope you guys enjoy. It's called Chronicles of Early California, 1535 to 1846. And it's called Lands of Promise and Despair. All right, we're page 9 of this book. And it's called 1510, The Invention of California, by Garcia Rodriguez de Montalvo. And it says here, the name California first appeared in a work published in Seville in 1510 by Garcia Rodriguez de Montalvo, entitled The Labors of the Very Brave Knight Esplandian. All right, so we already got in the other journal that the name California was actually around way before that, all right? But we're just going to read this just for reference, right? It says, Rodriguez de Montalvo was born in the middle of the 15th century. He participated in the final phases of the Reconquista and was knighted for his service at Alhama de Granada in 1482. All right, so I think the Reconquista was when they took back Spain from the Moors. All right. By the 1490s, he was hard at work on his 5-volume set, Amadis de Gaula, one of the first of many published books of fiction on the themes of chivalry and courtly love, which so captivated the Spanish reading public during the age of exploration and conquest. The first 4 volumes represented Rodriguez Montalvo's reworking of oral legends that were centuries old. The 5th volume, whose composition was begun in the 1490s and which was partly influenced by the tales brought back to Spain by Columbus and the early explorers, was Rodriguez Montalvo's own creation. All right, so this is very important what we just read there. So remember, they're giving this guy the credit for the source for the word California. He made it up in his romance about Queen Khalifa we're going to read. But look what it says here. It says that this 5th volume, where they actually got this story of Queen Khalifa, whose composition was begun in the 1490s. Look at this, 1490s. Which one? 98, 96, 97, 94, before or after Columbus went to America? Had to be before, after, because 1490s, he was here 1492. There's a whole 8 years thereafter that it could have been composed, right? So it says, was partly influenced by the tales brought back to Spain by Columbus and the early explorers. Was Rodriguez Montalvo's own creation. So this composition that Montalvo did, again, this was his own creation, basically from inspired by tales brought back by Columbus. I wonder what Columbus told him. All right, so now we're in this basically scholarly, journal. It's called The Transactions and Precedents of the Geographical Society of the Pacific, and it's Volume 6, Part 1. This is from 1910. All right. Again, the contents of this is the origin and meaning of the name California. Khalifa, the queen of the island of California. All right. This is by George Davidson, PhD, president of the Geographical Society of the Pacific. Even when the name California is traced to its first appearance in the exploits of Esplandian, there is no explanation offered about its origin. All right. So we've known that they say it comes out of that, but we know that it was already there before that. We already read this in the other books. All right. So even he's letting you know, okay, well, yeah, this dude put it in this romance this time. But where did he get the name California? How did he come up with it? And associate it to a woman, an Amazonian, on a distant island. All right. That's what he's saying. It doesn't offer no explanation to its origin. But from Theo H. Hiddle commences by saying the first account of California that is found in old records represented it as an island rich in pearls and gold. It was said to lie at a distance of 10 days' journey from the province of Cihuatanc, and to be inhabited by women only. All right, so I want to bring you to this book, which is The Letters of Cortez, so we can get an account from Cortez himself. This is actually what he wrote to the Emperor Charles V. So this is a collection of 5 letters, all right, that he wrote to Charles V. This is a book I got. It's called Letters of Cortez, the 5 letters of relation from Fernando Cortez, another name. You might know him as Hernando, but it's actually another way, Fernando Cortez to the Emperor Charles V. Translated and edited with biographical introduction and notes compiled from original sources, all right? Original sources by Francis Augustus MacNeud in 2 volumes, all right? And this is in volume 2 that I got here. I got both volumes 1 and 2. We're going to page 177 in this book, and we're going to go down to the part where we're talking about in our video, which is Queen Khalifa, right? That lived in a mythical island full of women. All right, so we're in a part of the book with Cortez is telling Charles V, right, that how he's conquering all these provinces, and even though they lost men and they're conquering them one by one, and he's doing so good and all that, right? He says, namely, the province of Aliman, Colimante, and Cihuatanc. This is in Mexico, all right? He says what he found there, which was rich in gold and pearls, right? Very rich in gold and pearls in Cihuatanc. But also that they were bringing back stories from there. All right, so let me just start right here. It says, in his description of these provinces, there was very news of very good port on that coast, which greatly pleased me because they are few. He likewise brought me an account of the chiefs of the province of Cihuatanc. All right, from the chiefs, meaning from the aboriginals there. So this is a story from the Indians there, the chiefs, the aboriginals, all right, of that province of Cihuatanc, who affirmed to the Spanish, right, that there is an island. There is what? An island inhabited only by women without any men, by women without any men, an island inhabited by women without any men. This is chiefs, aboriginals telling this story to Cortez. So as I'm trying to show you here is that, as you can see, this story didn't start in a romance, in a Spanish romance. All right, so we got to dodge the hijack. All right, it's deeper than that. So we're getting a whole different source here. Now it's a local story, right? And it continues saying, and that at given times, men from the mainland visit them. If they conceive, they keep the female children to which they give birth. But the males they throw away. This island is 10 days' journey from the province. And many of them went thither and sighed, and told me also that it is very rich in pearls and gold. All right? So they're saying it's 10 days from where they are in Mexico, almost central Mexico, 10 days journey. That makes sense to go to California? About 10 days journey? It's not that far. I shall strive to ascertain the truth, and when I'm able to do so, I shall make a full account to your majesty. All right? So that's Cortez, again, letting us know that he knew about basically Queen Khalifa, because he heard the story from the chiefs in Cihuatanc that was passed to him just from the Spaniards that were conquering over there. All right, so they already had the scoop. So again, remember, they started writing these romances, right? Montalvo wrote it because he got influenced from, you know, Columbus when he was coming back in the 1490s, right? We already got that earlier, all right? So I just wanted to show you, right, so you can get a clear perspective. We're going to continue to talk about Cortez later on, but I just want to show you that the source says it himself. All right, let's go back to the other book. All right, so Cortez letting you know that he didn't get the name California from a romance he read. All right, he would have wrote it right there. I mean, he wouldn't even need to write it, because that would have been part of, you know, common knowledge. Charles V would have known that, because he would have given the book, would have told him, go look for this land, right? Even though they did, you know, they knew what they were coming to do and who they're coming to conquer. Let's not get too lost, all right? So this ain't no romance, All right, they're going to tell you, yeah, you know, we figured it out. It came out of a fictional romance. Because they try to say romances are fictional. They try to throw that suggestion at us. But if you really study the etymology of romance, you really study this. These are all basically inspired by real history. Most of these romances, this is just the way they told the story, right, in the play. Such was the strange story brought to Mexico from Colima by Gonzalo de Sandoval and transmitted by Cortes to the Emperor Charles V, all right? So this is what Cortes, Hernando Cortes, was telling Emperor Charles V, all right, who also invaded the Incas. In the latter part of the year 1524, he adds in a footnote, the account is contained in the Carta Cuarta de Relación, dated October 15, 1524. Francisco de Orellana's chronicler, the Dominican Fray Gaspar de Carvajal, transplanted the fable to regions of the Amazon River in the wild search for El Hombre Dorado, or the Golden Man. Not El Dorado, like a place. It actually was a person. In 1522, Cortes sent Gonzalo de Sandoval to succor Cristóbal de Olid, who had gone to Colima. And from him, we have the report of a very rich island, peopled with Amazons, 10 days' journey from Colima. This legend appears in the fourth letter of Cortes to the Emperor Carlos V, dated October 15, 1524. All right, reporting women warriors, an island of women warriors in America. That's what he's saying. In 1529, a large expedition left Mexico to continue the discoveries of Olid and Sandoval, but especially to reach the island. In the Historia de Nueva España, escrita por su esclarecido conquistador Hernán Cortés, aumentada con otros documentos, all right, augmented with other documents. So they're talking about this book that Hernán Cortés wrote, all right. So this story is given in detail. As a matter of history, it eventually killed the legend of the Amazon. We read that earlier, how Hernán Cortés mentions the island of California peopled by women warriors. So it killed the fact, like it debunked that it was a legend, is basically what he's saying. Eventually killed the legend of Amazon as a matter of history. All right, this was in detail as a matter of history. It eventually killed the legend of the Amazon, the legend. It was real. The belief in the Amazons was not confined to the conquerors of Mexico. It preceded their advent and was extended to both the Americas. It says, Columbus heard of the Amazons on his first voyage. In his letter of March 4, 1493, and speaking of the Caribs, he says, they are the same who have intercourse with the women on the first island, which is found on the voyage from Spain to the Indies, on which no men live. These do not follow any womanly occupations, but use bows and arrows of cane, like those mentioned above, and cover, and arm themselves with brazen plates, of which they have many. Had women warriors, they had brazen plates, they fought bows and arrows. It was mostly women. So there was groups of these, seems like there was groups of these Amazons everywhere in the Americas, all right? The legend appears first in the fourth letter of Cortes to the Emperor Carlos V or Charles V, dated October 15th, 1524. And among the reports which he, Gonzalo Sandoval, brought from that province, Colima, was an account of a very good harbor, a Puerto Escondido, or a hidden harbor, Acapulco, in question marks, which was found on that coast. And also, he told me of the lords of the province of Cihuatán, that many of them asserted there was an island inhabited only by women without any grown man among them, and that from time to time men went out to them from the mainland. When they bore daughters, they kept them, but the sons were put away. This island is 10 days distance from the province, and many of the principal men had gone there from the province and had seen them. I was also told they were rich in pearls and gold. All right, page 114. This is from Hernán Cortés' own words to Charles V, all right, his boy. All right? And he's clearly telling you, all right, because this matches basically, we already read the story of Queen Khalifa, right, how they would only keep the baby, the female children, and they say they would kill the males, throw them in the water, feed them to the griffins, all right? So this story that Cortes got from the aborigines, the the people he met in Mexico, telling him, you know, that there was an island of women matches exactly with what the Queen Khalifa story in Esplandian's so-called romance Spanish, you know, book or whatever. And as you guys can see, this is more than just a romance story. This was a real person. This was in the Indies. She was copper-colored. And she was a warrior, queen. We got a good video coming up about the Amazon warrior women. I wanted to do a refresh of this one real quick. Just to show it's more than just a European romance story. Regarding the Black Panther Marvel movie. And that, you know, we talked about the Jaguar Warriors earlier. Now I want to talk to you about the Dora Milaje, the women warriors from the movie Black Panther, and how they are supposedly a representation of the ancient Dahomey Amazons of Africa. So let's dig into this. It says here, Dahomey Amazons. The Dahomey Amazons, or Mino, which means our mothers, were a fun all-female military regiment of the Kingdom of Dahomey in the present-day Republic of Benin, which lasted until the end of the 19th century. They were so named by Western observers and historians due to their similarity to the mythical Amazons of ancient Anatolia and the Black Sea. So they were named Amazonians, like the fabled Amazonian women warriors. All right, they're not the actual Amazonians. You get what I'm saying? They were named due to the similarity to the mythical Amazons of ancient Anatolia and the Black Sea. Let's hear origin. All right, so pay attention. It says King Huegbaja, who ruled from 1645 to 1685, the third king of Dahomey, is said to have originally started the group, which would become the Amazons, as a corps of elephant hunters called the Jebeto. All right, so again, when did they start? When did this warrior clan group, women warriors, when was it originally started? It says here, in between 1645 to 1685. All right, so that was started after. All right, it doesn't go any more ancient than that. So they're not referring to the, ancient Amazonian warriors that we had taught about in Greek mythology and legends, right? But look at the word Amazonians. Why are they? Where does this word come from, Amazonians? If you don't know, we get the story of the Amazonian warriors from mostly from Greek mythology, and it says here, since the epics of the Homeric poets, there have been references to mysterious and frightening stories of the Amazons. In the Iliad, composed around the 8th century BC, the Amazons were referred to as a man-like seasoned fighters. Man-like seasoned fighters. The implication is that in war, they were a match for men. And in terms of their prowess, physical strength, and courage, the Amazons appear in other Greek myths, such as the adventures of Heracles and Theseus. Herodotus recorded detailed information, possibly spurious, but nevertheless fascinating, about this tribe of women. In his account, the Amazons were presented as horse riders, skilled with the bow and arrow, deft with the spear, and ignorant of traditional women's work. All right, so we're taught that this is a fable, this is a legend, it's just mythology. But where do they get these legends and mythology from? You know they hijacked the aboriginal truth. Because as it says here, it says the Amazons, the mythological Amazons, a kingdom of fierce warrior women, had fired European imaginations since the days of antiquity. Many of the conquistadors and explorers were on the constant lookout for legendary things and places. Christopher Columbus claimed to have found the Garden of Eden. And that's in the Orinoco when he got there, I believe on his third or fourth voyage. You know, he said that this must be coming, this river Orinoco from the terrestrial paradise. And Juan Ponce de León's search for the Fountain of Youth, which has already talked about that, right, are but two examples. As they made their way along the river, Orellana and his men heard tell of a kingdom of women and decided they had found the legendary Amazons. They believed, based on accounts extracted from natives along the way, that the mighty kingdom of the Amazons was a few days inland and that the river villages were Amazon vassal states. On one occasion, the Spanish saw women battling alongside men in one of the villages they raided. These, they assumed, must be the Amazons. According to Father Gaspar de Carvajal, whose eyewitness account survives today, the women were nearly naked, fair-skinned warriors who fought fiercely and who shot a bow so hard as to drive an arrow deeply into the wood of the Spaniard's raft. Amazons in America by William Bond. The first reports of Amazon warriors in America comes from Christopher Columbus on March 4, 1493. Columbus wrote that he had encountered women warriors on the island of Martinique. He also claimed they covered themselves with copper plates and used bows and arrows made of sugar cane. This story is supported by Alfonso Ulloa, who accompanied Columbus on all four of his voyages to the New World. Also wrote about the women warrior of Martinique in his book, Historia del Señor Don Fernando Colombo. In this book, he wrote that the locals claimed that the island of Martinique was the only populated by women. Men from other islands would only come to the island at certain days of the year to collect boys and would bring the boy up. The Spanish also reported other islands called Las Mujeres, which means women in Spanish, and Cozumel, where again women warriors were seen. Cozumel is in Mexico. Unfortunately, these early Caribbean people were killed, raped, and enslaved by the Spanish conquistadors. Amazons were also reported by the Spanish in California. Right? Queen Khalifa, California, right? Or Queen Sheba, Khalif, California, the emblem of America. Again, so the Amazons were also reported by the Spanish in California. Unfortunately, these reports are very controversial because not only were these tribes ruled by women, they were also black. Again, not only were these tribes ruled by women, they were also black. All right, again, emblem of America shows the Queen Khalifa, right? Supposed to be an allegory, but it's actually representing the black nations, so-called black nations, the black Californians, the aboriginals of California. When the Spanish first came to California, they found two races of people, the Indian people with racial features similar to Chinese, Japanese, Philippines, and black Amazons. All right. Up until 1862, the origin of the name California was a mystery, until scholars discovered a novel written in 1521 by Garcia Ordonez de Montalvo, the book called The Exploits of the Very Powerful Cavalier Explandian, son of the excellent King Amadis of Gaul. Within this book was the story of Queen Califia, an Amazon queen. So it seems that when the Spanish first began to explore the northwest coast of America and discovered tribes of black Amazon women, they called the place California after this fictional Queen Califia. Fictional, right? But we know better. Now, the idea of black people in America before the Europeans discovered it is very controversial. But we've already debunked all that. We know the truth, right? The foundational truth. Who were the copper-colored tribes of America? Yet archaeologists have discovered bodies of people different to that of the Asiatic Native Americans. In Brazil, a female skull was discovered in Lucia having a long and narrow skull that was 12,000 years old. The same is true in Mexico. In Penan, another woman's skull was found of a similar type, 13,000 years old. What is even more controversial about all these skulls is that they're very much the same as Australia, Aborigines, or African Bushmen. So if that is the case, what happened to these people? The black people in California just didn't suddenly disappear. They were later reported by the French and English explorers. The problem is that as black slaves from Africa were imported into America, they were confused in the minds of the European settlers with the native black people.
again, as black slaves from Africa were imported into America, they were confused in the minds of the European settlers with the native black people. As these people had no voice in the white man's history, their origins were obscured and forgotten. Okay? And until now, we're relearning, we're remembering, we're waking up, right? All right. Let's continue. In the book, The Discovery of the Large, Rich, and Beautiful Empire of Guyana, or Guyana with a Y, right? With a relation of the great and golden city of Manoa, which the Spaniards call El Dorado, performed in the year 1595 by Sir Walter Raleigh. It says here, with regard to the account of the Amazons, it is not given us from personal observation, but as a report received from Indians, and current at the period we Raleigh wrote in his Guyana voyage, in which even Condamine, the French academician, considered probable, adducing many testimonies in its favor in a discourse delivered before the French Academy. The account of a tribe of Amazons is almost coeval with the discovery of America. Christopher Columbus was told that the small island of Madanino, or Mati Nino, Montserrat, was inhabited by warlike women. And you get that account in many different books, all right? Montserrat. Orellana, in his Descent of the Marañón, was cautioned at the mouth of the Napo by an old chieftain to beware of the warlike women, and asserts that he afterwards met female fighting in the ranks of men. Hernando de Ribera, the follower of Cabeza de Vega, the conquistador of Paraguay, asserts in 1545 that he heard a nation of Amazons who lived on the western side of a large lake, which was poetically called the Mansion of the Sun, because that orb sang in these traditions. The missionary Gili heard from an Indian of the Quaqua tribe that the Aike Binanos, literally the women living alone, inhabited the banks of the Cuchivero, which falls into the Orinoco opposite the island of Taran, between Caicara and Alta Gracia. Condamine further adduces the testimony of two Spanish governors of the province of Venezuela, Don Diego Francisco with a question mark, Portales and Don Francisco Torralba, which agreed in substance that a tribe of warlike women dwelt in the interior of Guyana. It is, however, extraordinary that if the tradition originated with Europeans, it was not only still in existence at the time of Condamine's voyage, but is even now current among all the Indian tribes who have had intercourse with the Caribs. The Indians of the lower Quarantine of the Essequibo and the Rupununi declared to us in the gravest manner during our travels in these regions that the separate hordes of females still live on the upper part of the Quarantine in a country called Marawone. The accounts we received respecting the country they inhabited were accompanied by such details that the tradition assumed some probability. All right, they're saying some probability. This is real. These are facts. It would, however, be unjust to condemn Raleigh's proneness to a belief in their existence when we find that even Southey, the learned historian of Brazil, makes his remark, had we never heard of the Amazons of antiquity, I should without hesitation believe in those of America. Their existence is not the less likely for that reason, and yet it must be admitted that the probable truth is made to appear suspicious by its resemblance to a known fable. Again, this is not a fable. The Amazons are from the Amazons in America, warlike female groups. And this is before the 1600s, before the Dahomey Amazonians of Africa. And just one more thing, it says here, the Journal of Christopher Columbus during his first voyage, 1492-93, and the documents relating to the voyages of John Cabot and Gaspar Corte Real from the Halyuk Society. And it says here, on Tuesday 15th of January, the Admiral now wished to depart, for there was nothing to be gained by further delay after these occurrences and the tumult with the Indians. Today he had heard that all the gold was in the district of the town of Navidad, belonging to their highness, and that in the island of Carib there was much copper, as well as in Matinino. The intercourse at Carib would, however, be difficult, because the natives are said to eat human flesh. Their island would be in sight from thence, and the admiral determined to go there, and it was on the route and thence to Matinino, which was said to be entirely peopled by women without men. He would thus see both islands, and Columbus himself said on 4th March 1493 that these women warriors of old Martinique covered themselves with brazen plates and used bows and arrows of cane. These Amazons have many of these plates. Alfonso Ulloa, a companion of Columbus on the famous voyages, wrote in his Historia del S.D. Fernando Colombo that the admiral believed that the Indians' Caribs told him of the Amazons of Matanino, Matrimonio, or Martinique, because he saw the spirit and strength these women displayed. Ulloa also makes a significant comment, not that he appreciated the significance of the female cults of lunar worship practiced by these West Indian Amazons. Talking about West Indian Amazonians, so we have here Ana Caona, Golden Flower. She was from Haiti. It says this is around 1490. That's how she, I guess, presumably looked in 1490. Ana Caona was one of the highest caciques, or chief, katzin. Remember what that means. It's Hebrew for chief, too. Cacique, katzin. Ana Caona, again, was one of the highest caciques, or chief, who possessed the island of Hispaniola. When the Spaniards settled there, her date of birth and date of death are both unknown. She is a significant icon in early Haitian history, the primordial founder of Haiti, and she is considered to be the first Haitian hero. She is revered and immortalized in the intertwining histories of both Haiti and the Dominican Republic. Her name, Arawak, Ana Caona, means golden flowers. She married Caonabo. So let's remember Ana Caona, because it says here, Ana Caona became chief of Jaragua. After her brother's death, her husband, Caonabo, suspected of having organized a recent attack on La Navidad, a Spanish settlement on northwestern Hispaniola, was captured by Alonso de Ojeda and shipped to Spain, dying in a shipwreck during the journey, as many other Taino leaders died on Spanish ships away from their native lands. So who got enslaved and sent in ships? Indians, Native Americans. Future video, I'll show you the transatlantic slave trade where it started. The Tainos, being ill-treated by the conquerors, revolted and made a long war against them. In 1503, during a meeting of 80 caciques, including Ana Caona, the Spanish governor, Nicolas de Ovando, ordered the meeting house to be set on fire to burn them alive. Similar to what centuries later occurred to Rigoberta Menchu's family in Guatemala, Cacica Ana Caona and her Taino noblemen were arrested, all accused of conspiracy for resisting occupation, and executed. Prior to her execution, Ana Caona was offered clemency if she would give herself as concubine to one of the Spaniards, which was common in that area. Standing with her fellow Taínos in solidarity, the Caribbean indigenous female leader, Cacica, chose execution over colluding with the Spanish enemy. Her refusal cemented her legend. Ana Caona remained rebellious and independent until her violent public death. Because Ana Caona refused the sexual offer of the Spanish intruders while others were shot, Ana Caona was executed by hanging. She was only 29 years old. It's really, really, you know, I'm going to say it, fucked up what happened to the ancestors here of America. You know, in this.
All right, everybody, we're back. It appears that my guest is in the queue, and I hope you all wrote down the title and author of the book that he was getting this information from, so that you can do a cross reference, an investigation on your own for yourself, and add that. Book that to your library. Let me open up my guest phone line now, because we got to move forward here. Area code 904. Joi, are you on the air?
Yes, I'm here.
Okay, all right. Well, welcome. Hold on for 1 minute. There's something I got to do before we proceed, okay? Just hold on a moment.
Okay.
We'll be right back.
Okay. All right.
Area code 773, Dr. Walter Williams, you on the air.
Yes, sir, I'm here.
Okay, my brother, I want to make this as brief as I can. I would like to apologize to you for cutting you off on the air, and I hope you accept my apology.
Yes, I accept your apology, my brother.
Okay, my brother. All right, that's all I needed to know, and I thank you so much, man. We're finna proceed with the remainder of the broadcast. But thank you for calling.
Okay, I hope you success in the future, and carry on.
Okay, my brother.
Thank you.
Take care.
All right.
Uh-huh.
Okay, Joe, we back. Now, I got
okay.
your paperwork here.
Uh-huh.
We got the, and I want to start with the, this one, if you could explain it to me here, the Creator's Lunar Solar Calendar. Can you
uh-huh.
give us a breakdown on that?
Well, that lunar solar calendar is based on the vibrational frequencies of the movement of the sun and the vibrations of the movement of the moons. And so that particular calendar is based on, like I said, the sun and the moon. And it's usually, I guess since you asked that question, I have to explain this. The solar lunar calendar, along with some other calendars, they use the moon to determine the first day of the new month, because, you know, we know that word moon, that word month comes from the word moon. And in society, we have been taught, or at least I was taught, that the new moon marks the first day of the month. But the new moon, and that's based on the moon looking like the little C, you know, when it first appears and restarts the cycle, it looks like a backward C. That one,
okay.
that we had been taught that is the new moon, but that is not the new moon. The new moon is when the moon is full. And I concluded that through some studies, and most people are familiar with what's in the Bible. The Bible tells us that we should observe the moon. And when the moon first appears in that little, what I call a backward C, that is just the beginning of observing. And as time progressed, that moon gets bigger and bigger. And when it's, as I said, when it gets full, that is a new moon, because it is complete. You can't call the beginning of it new, because it is not full. It's new when it's full. And when that moon is full, the very next day marks the first day of that month. And it has nothing to do with the named months that we have, like January, February, March, and everything. And it's so much more that goes with that. I would have to take some more time to explain all of that.
All right. Well, we're gonna have to get down in there so we get it fully explained. However, the days of the week, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, where that came from, what that's about?
Well, all of those are pagan named days. Sunday is basically a day for sun worshipers. Monday is a day of moon worshipers. Tuesday is Twa. Wednesday is Wudin. Thursday is Thor. Friday is Frigg. Saturday is Saturnalia. Those are all pagan named days. And I deal with the Creator, or the Creator of the universe, as being the one that created days, months, years, and on and on. And I do not think that the Creator would have named the days of the week after pagan named God. And also, our days are not named. Our days are numbered.
Okay. You want to, because see, like right now, it is July the 30th. Could you give us a breakdown on the count of a calendar? If we're looking at the month of July, how do you count that?
Looking at the month of July, I know this may be not something new to some people, but we have, and you're taking me in an area I wasn't trying to go in right now, but we actually have 9 days in a week, not 7.
Okay.
That was created by man. We have 9 days, and as you know, this information is just one section from the entire study observation I did, and it's called number 9, Universal Perfection and Completion. And the subtitle of this is Clock Time is Not the Creator's Time. And as I said, we have 9 days in a week. And again, even the names of the month are pagan named months. And when we consider 9 days in a week, 9 days, 4 weeks of 9 days is 36 days a month. And what man has done, they cut it down, and that's why we now have 1 month may have 30 days, 1 month may have 31 days, one of those months have some years it has 28 days, some years it has 29 days. So it throws the whole flow of time off. So I don't know. So okay. So did I answer that?
Yep. You sure did.
I'm sorry. What I wanted to make a point of, you mentioned July, and I said our months are not named. There's only one month that is named in our true calendar, and that is the month that usually falls around, I would say, February. Like I said, you're causing me to get in too much, because we actually have, don't be too much to explain, we actually have 9 months in a year. January, December, January, and February was added. And so that the new year, when the new year comes in, which is the springing, that's going to take us into summer. And in that, the month that is named, it is called Abib, which means new year, new beginning. That's the only named month that we have. And when I say we, I'm talking about the aborigines of these lands here in America and Canada and other lands that are the lands of the original people of these lands. And we lived by the creator's calendar that is depicted through signs in nature. So that is the only month that is named. And say, for instance, you say July. I don't have that that calendar in front of me now, so take some digging to get to it. But say July, I'll just go back here. About the end of June, I'm sorry, I don't have my calendar with me in front of me. At the end of June, after the beginning of the month, at the end of June, say for instance, let's say June the 12th. Say June the 12th could be if June the 12th was the, say, 7th month. Or no, let's take it back. Say if June 15th starts the 7th month. And you count from the 15th 36 days later. And a lot of times that's going to roll over into August. And again, it's not about the 30-day thing. It's actually 36 days. Let's move on.
I think we pretty much got it that time. One of your documents here that says humans have accomplished abolishing things that were put in perfect order by the Most mm-hmm. High Creator. It has mm-hmm. been documented, and it seems quite logical, that two or three pagan named months were added to make a year's calendar a 12-month year. December,
right.
January, February, mm-hmm. according to the human-made mm-hmm. pagan named month. There yeah. is no end to things documented and hidden in plain sight that tell us the truth. Example, see below mystery of the month, hints in history, 4 months, September, October, November, and December in the Latin order of those months, and they stand numerologically as 7, 8, 9, and 10, geographically known as the 9th, 10th, 11th, and 12th months. At one mm-hmm. point in time, Latin was the dominant force circulating the writings and literature. So I got this down here, and I'm not going to get all down in there because this is kind of heavy down here. But what I want you to go back to, and we're going to be back to this here now, but what I want you to do, you ask your father to tell you about slavery and whether or not your family was a part of slavery or had ever been enslaved. What did he tell you?
He told me no. I asked him, I said, Daddy, I said, do you know of any your family members that were slaves or anybody that you know of during the time when you were coming? And at the time, Daddy was 86. And he says, no. He kind of thought about it. I say, what about your mother, which would have been much older than him? And again, he said, no. There are many people, when you ask them about slavery, some of them don't even know what that is.
Well, I have to agree with that. I asked my mama and my grandmama, some of her sisters are still alive today.
Yeah.
And I asked them, and they got upset with me. Especially my mama, she said, like, slavery? We heard about that kind of stuff, but it had nothing to do with us. We weren't no slaves. We always been him.
That's right. And that's because we live. I know we can get into a lot on that subject because, you know, like your mom said, they were already here. And I don't know if we want to get into that because that's a whole other subject.
Okay, well, I'm trying to do the first people on the lands of the Americas and the illusion of time. But what I'm going to do right now, let's take a little quick break. And when we come back, we'll get on back down in there. I'm going to mute your mic, and when we come back, I'm going to open it back up, okay?
Okay. All right.
Y'all hold on.
I want to hold you forever. I know forever may seem like a mighty long time, but in this case, baby, it ain't long at all. 'Cause when I see those big beautiful eyes looking into mine, I wanna hold you forever. So many songs have said these same things before, but this one does for you and me. So if it's all right with you, I'm gonna sing it. I wanna love you forever. about the rest of our lives. Through thick and thin, I'll be there by your side.
Special guest is Pearls of Joi, and I'm going to open up a phone line so we can get back in and continue with today's broadcast. Joi, are you still with me?
Yes, I'm here.
Okay. Now, let's go over here because I got a first of all, ladies and gentlemen, Joi is the author of a book called The Gift of Law. The Gift of Law is The Gift of Love. Okay. How's that book? Is that book still out there, Joi?
Yeah, it's still out there. It's on Amazon. Yeah. Okay. I did that book, what, about, since back in, what, I finished it back in 2014?
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah.
Now, I got your document here. A complete circle measures a complete cycle of 360
mm-hmm.
degrees, or does it?
On page,
these 360 days in a year are 324 days. Notice how the zero causes one number to shift, 270, that eliminates 360 in the cycle below. Now, I'm looking
mm-hmm.
at this chart here, and that's the one with the big black circle.
Yeah.
You want to try to explain that to us?
Okay, well, that circle actually has the measurement of a circle, supposedly. But if you look at it, I structured it to kind of show how that same pattern is used to calculate the time on a clock. And there are four different increments on a clock. For instance, an hour has four increments, and the way that I'm showing that, I'm showing that there is 36 hours in a day, not 24, because there's nine. Yeah. So you say, like I say, you yeah. Okay, go ahead.
So when you're saying that, you're including the whole 24-hour equation.
Uh-huh.
Is that
well,
right?
Or not
do I
really.
Have wrong?
Okay, well, okay. And that's why I said you're kind of covering some stuff that's going to take us, you know, I would have to start it off from the beginning to basically break it down. But I guess to try to clarify this even more, that's just the circle. That's not the actual clock, but I had to do some improvising on that. Okay, help me out here. What was the question again? Because like I said, I'm a little bit thrown off.
Okay, well, I think we'll be doing our audience, listening audience a little bit. Whoa!
I'm sorry.
We're in a thunderstorm down here in Florida, y'all.
I just came through it.
Just give me the definition of what is time? What is
time.
The definition of minute, hour,
okay.
and second? Define that.
Okay, what is time? Time is the when we're talking about in the universe, it is the natural physical vibrational frequency of the elements within the earth, you know, like the stars, the sun, and the moon, and the elements on the earth, like the plants and vegetation and the animals and things like that. Okay. And time, when it comes to what the foreigners has created in a clock, that time is space matter energy. So time is space matter energy vibrating on a frequency within the universe that manifests through, like I said, science and nature. Now, time created by the foreigners is the illusion of time created to mimic and control the narrative of time with the clock instrument. That's why we have deadlines, last chance, your last opportunity. We're going to close at a certain time. It puts limitations on time, where in natural time does not have limitations. And the illusion of clock time is condensed on an instrument to show time according to manipulated methods. I call that man polluted. Human made clock time is an illusion of time that is sometimes hung on a wall or wrapped around the wrist. That system is designed to keep the eyes of the mind in tune with the illusion of time that disconnects us from nature. If you want me to go on, I have some more things I want to share about time.
Go ahead.
This came from the Etym Online. That's the etymology online, and it describes the term time as English tima, which is limited space of time, and that's the one that I was mentioning as the human-made time puts limits on time. It is from the Proto-Germanic timon, which means time, and it is that source is from the Old Norse time and time, proper time, and the Swedish time, which is in an hour, they call it, from P-I-E or daimon, suffix from the root da, I ain't gonna go into that, to divide. The definition of their time is contingent upon their foreign language, which is totally opposite from the original languages of the aborigines of these lands. And you see, there's things that we cannot fully grasp or understand because we are speaking a foreign language that is not our language. And the way our language is, it does not work like the English language or any other language. And the words in our original language it is not the same as the English language. So because the English language add to, take away, it twists things, it turns it, it flips it, in our language did not have vowels in it. So in order for us to understand a lot of things, we have got to come back to learn our pure, true language.
All right. Well, you want to give us a little bit more about our ancient story, what they're calling our ancient history. You want to drop a little bit more of that for
us? I'm sorry. Say that again.
I see you want to give us a little bit more information on that.
On what I'm talking about here now? Yeah. Here's the thing. Say that again.
On our ancient culture, our ancient history, our ancient story.
Okay, and which part of our ancient history do you want to discuss?
Any one of them that you feel comfortable with.
Okay. Well, you know what? Let me tell you this because I know you asked me, how did our ancestors tell time?
Yep.
Did you want to get into that?
Yep.
Okay. Our ancestors told time by nature. And, you know, I said a moment again, this human-made time was created to disconnect us from being in tune with nature to be able to tell time. And here's a quote from a book titled Basic Herbs for Health and Healing by Rashan Abdul-Hakim, also known as Rudy Duckett, page 19, and it is titled American Indians and Herbology. The Indians learned the value of everything in their environment through their instinctual sense and by living in close harmony with nature. They told time by the plant, the sun, and the stars, and forecast the weather with great accuracy. They drew exact maps of their surroundings without the aid of scientific instruments, end quote. Now notice that they did not use the moon to count days. The moon is used to count months. They did not know the Latin names of the herbs, but they knew the power and function of the herbs and plants in nature. So in other words, these plants and things did not get these names until the colonizers, the foreigners came, the Spanish and the people speaking Latin, and they gave the plants and everything Latin names. But our ancestors knew what these plants was and what they did long before those foreigners came. Another question you asked me, how should we tell time? And I say that we tell time the way our ancestors told time, by the element in the earth. An example, here's an example from my own experience. As I observed the season of spring starting to break forth, there are certain things. Say, for instance, you will start to see the red cardinals. That is a sign of the spring breaking forth to prepare for summer. There are certain flowers that bloom. We start to see the flowers and everything start to bloom, to bud and to bloom. And the thing about it, I observed this for several years now. And when this happened, they told us that January the 1st is the beginning of the new year, and they say spring is in April. I saw these things manifest in February. Actually, the beginning of spring actually starts in February. Because, think about it, February would not have been there as a, say, second month if they had not added those, I'll say, 2 to 3 extra months to the calendar. So, and then there was a, but if I go over, I was going to talk about the fact that the spring, the summer, and everything, there's always signs that tell us what time it is, but I don't want to go over there. I want to kind of stay with this here because, like I said, it'll take me where I got to come back and forth in between too many different things, and I want to try to, keep it focused. There was another. Go ahead.
No, I'm listening. I said, okay.
Okay, yeah.
Go ahead.
Yeah, and there was another question we talked about, and that is, what vibrational frequency should we be using? We should be operating on a frequency that is in tune with nature, body and mind. We are connected with nature. We are in tune with nature because we are one with nature. We interact with nature through the foods we eat, the things we put on and in our bodies, such as unadulterated food, what I want to say is unadulterated food is electric energy. That's where we get our energy and vibration from, the food. But we live in a world where the foods are genetically modified. So many things have been tampered with that has destroyed all of the real nutrients in it that gives us our power and our strength and our vibration. And we're supposed to be operating on the same vibration like the movement of the earth, as the sun is moving about, as the stars and nature, everything. We should be vibrating, and I always use the example of a heartbeat. It should be like a heartbeat. As the sun is striking, boom, 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 tap, tap, tap. We are supposed to be operating in the same exact way when we have our electric energy.
Okay. Well, now, let me ask you this. In your opinion, based on what we've been witnessing, because I don't know about your tribe, but I know my tribe. The big day the insight on how to watch nature and all that business. I've been doing that for years and years and years. I got trees everywhere around here out of the road. But anyway, in your opinion, where are we headed as a nation of people today, in your opinion?
Well, I would say even though we are and have been subject to, say, weather manipulations and modifications that throw off the natural balance of nature. And with that happening, people are experiencing a lot of different things, such as depression, emotional stuff going on. And again, the food, because what they have been doing to the weather is destroying the ground, which destroys the seed in the ground, which hinders the food. And then, of course, again, they take it, they do things to it, they add to it, they take away from it. And that was taking us down to total destruction. As I mentioned earlier, the earth is being reclaimed. Things are being destroyed that is not in concert with nature, because it's all about us flowing in love and reconnecting with nature. So that's where we're headed, or should be heading, is coming back and reconnecting with nature.
Okay, well, I have to agree with that, because we got sharks and whales attacking boats in the Atlantic. We got seals and otters snatching a surfboard from surfers. We got down here in Florida, we got the coral reefs to start getting bleached out. So now if the coral go, that's out. You know that.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Well, this I believe, is Mother Nature fighting back. Because the man has destroyed everything, the ecosystem, the Amazon, and all of those things. They have destroyed the ecosystem and many other things. And so we see a lot of things I believe is being exhausted so that it can be restored.
Okay. Well, I tell you what, we're going to take another little quick break, and when we come back, then we'll continue on, okay?
Okay.
All right. Y'all hold on. Ladies and gentlemen, we're listening to Joi, and we are talking about the first people on the lands of the Americas and the illusion of time. And we'll come back, and we'll get back down to some more of that. So y'all hold on a minute. We'll be right back. everybody. We're back. Our special guest is Joi, Pearls of Joi. And we're dealing with the first peoples of the land of the Americas and the illusion of time. We're going to go back into this time thing again. I'm going to open up a phone line and make sure she's still with us. I don't know, because we are experiencing some heavy thunderstorms down here in Florida at this very minute. And so if everything disappears and you don't hear my voice no more, that means they done took us out. Okay, but in the meantime, we still rocking and rolling. Now, Joi, how do you think we ought to count?
Well, I think we should count because the extra added numbers. I'll say it like this here. I recall when I was in school, which was a long time ago, they taught us to count from 0 to 9. And it was 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Later on, they changed it and had us to count from 1 to 0. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 0. Now, 0 is another character that was added to create the number 10. There's really no such thing as 10, and 0 is not a number. 0 does not have any numerical value. They put that in by taking the 1 and adding a 0 next to it and calling it 10, which at that point, gave us an extra character in our 1 through 9 numerical system, because there's only 9 numbers, actually. That's 1 through 9. And then when they took, after they added the 0 to the 1 to create 10, then they took 2 of the 1s and put it together and created the number 11. And then again, they took the 1 and the 2 and put it together and called it the 12. But when you calculate it and look at it for what it is, 1 stands alone, and then 1 stands alone, and 1 plus 2 is 3. But they put those two numbers together and created a 12, but it's actually 3. And it goes on down the line in their system. But yes, we should be counting from 1 to 9. Say for instance, I work out, right? And I know even when I used to work out years ago, they would do a count of the exercises, a count of 8. You do 8 repetitions. And I said like this, I think that because the foreigners know that 9 is the perfect universal number, and the foreigners, they want to take the credit for everything that's created, and they don't want to deal with anything that the Most High has created. So it's like they just diss the 9. And they use 8. And another thing they'll say, it is said that 8 means new beginning. How could 8 mean new beginnings when 8 is in the 8th place? 1 is new beginning. So so we should be counting to 9. And in the equation of 9, it's always a value of, say, 36. Whether it be hundreds, thousands, or whatever, 36 is a perfect equation of 9. So we should be counting from 1 to 9. And then some may say, well, what about 12, 13, and 14? Like I said, those numbers really don't exist. Once you get to 9, going back to when I say when I work out and I count, and I will do a repetition for 9 times. And then after the 9, I don't do 10. I'll start over again. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. And every time we stay in that sequence of the nine, it is always going to equate to either 3,600, thousands, millions, billions, infinity.
Okay. Well, this is some interesting stuff here. Let me see if I can verify some of this stuff you just told us about that nine. Because
okay.
If we, earlier before you got on the broadcast, we dealt with nines and shapes and minutes and seconds and all that, put a little bit of that out. And I stated that if you got a square, because we live in a square world, houses made in a square, tornadoes and hurricanes can't them down. All four corners on that square is at a 90-degree angle. Four times nine is 36.
Right.
Six plus three is nine. If
That's
we
right.
did a triangle, now we officially got three corners. Those three corners is 60 degrees apiece. Three times six is 18. Well, one plus eight is back to the nine.
Right, back to the nine.
If I added up the sum total of 1 to 9, I'll come up with the number 36, but 6 plus 3 is 9.
Exactly.
If I added up the sum total of all digits going to 9, that'll be 45. 5 plus 4 is 9. I think this is enough verification. If I did the 360-degree circle and cut half in two, that's 180 degrees apiece.
That's right.
If I did
that's
the
right.
whole circle, 6 degrees, 3 plus 6 plus 0 is still 9.
Right.
All right.
Yes,
so
always.
You was absolutely correct at that. Let me look at the rest of these papers that you didn't gave me over here. Let me see what else we got. Okay, we done dealt with the false names of the week. Let's see.
Yeah.
We done dealt with that.
Yep.
All right. You got everything straight. You got anything that you want to tell us about your book for folks to go out and buy it off of Amazon? The title is The Book Giver of Love.
So that book, it's called The Gift of Law is the Gift of Love. And it is talking about the laws, what is called the laws among, say, the religions, Christianity, and different ones. And in those arenas, we were taught that we're no longer under the law, that we're under grace. And that was misunderstood because the laws sounded heavy or something that required a lot. But no, the laws of the Creator is is the instructions of the Creator. And so when we say we're no longer under the law, we're saying that we're no longer under the instructions of the Creator, because that's what that's what law means. And in that book, I go into breaking down some of the laws that are written, and I deal with the fact that, you know, as I said, they said that we were taught that we're no longer under the law, we're under grace. And I continue explaining grace is basically like a defense. It's like a fence that, say, for instance, if we're indulging in some things or doing some things that are not righteous at all, karma is going to come back. But grace, out of the grace of the Creator, keeps you from being attacked by putting that fence of grace around you until you get it right. And sometimes sometimes we know we may be doing some things that's not right, and we continue to do it over and over again, and there comes a time sometimes where the grace lifts, and when that grace lifts, you dead meat for the enemy. And so I talk about a lot of different things in that particular book, like I said, proving that the gift of law is the gift of love, because our Creator loved us so much, and our Creator knew what we were going to be exposed to in this world. Therefore, the Creator gave us instructions on how to do this, how to give this. And so that's pretty much what, and him telling us how to do these things, that is the love that the Creator gives us by giving. That's just like I know, a lot of people are parents. You give your children instructions on how they should do things. They don't always do it the way they should, but it's the same thing with our Creator. He is giving us instructions on how to live, how to live in this world that He has created for us. So that's kind of pretty much it in a nutshell. But there's a lot of different information in there.
Okay, so there is a power out there that is watching over us and making sure we do the same thing right.
I'm sorry, say that again.
You think that there's a power out there in the universe that's looking down on us?
Nope.
And watching us, in your opinion. You say no? Okay.
Nope.
All right. That's it. All right, we got an hour and 20 minutes. I'm gonna take one more break, and then we'll be back, and then we'll continue. How about that?
Okay.
All right. Ladies and gentlemen, y'all, we'll be right back.
A crowd of people gathered round, all dressed in black. And as they removed her body from the car, such a pain I never knew, it filled my heart. I lost the only one I've ever loved. The Lord has returned the up above. It happened on a Saturday night. My love and I had just had a silly fight. She got into her car and angrily drove away. Neither of us knew then that she'd never see another day. What have I done wrong to deserve this misery? All my life and all of my world has come falling down on me. I was at home watching my TV. What the doctor meant when he informed me that there had been an accident. Why, oh why, I heard her mother cry as I rushed to the scene with the tears in my eyes. Somebody asked who was the next of kin.
Dealing with the first peoples on the land of the Americas and the illusion of Are you still with me?
I'm sorry, I can't hardly hear you.
Can you hear me now?
I hear you better.
Okay. All right. Because we got a whole lot of storms and stuff going on down here. So it might get kind of rough.
Oh, yeah. Right, yeah, because I had to drive through it to get back on time. Huh?
Okay.
Okay.
Now,
you know what? I just wanted to, I'm sorry, before you finish that, I don't mean to cut you off. I wanted to make one more point about that question about is the Creator looking down on us, you know, watching over us? The Creator is in us. And so there are already triggers and things within us that will, if we're doing something that's not right, there's a spirit of conviction that will convict us from the inside, and we'll know, you know, that we're not on track because the Creator is in us and we're in the Creator. So the Creator don't have to be looking at us because everything that we need is already in us, even that gauge that tells us we're off track. And we have the will to get it right. We have the will to make the choice.
Okay.
So I just wanted to get that in.
Your definition of God is what?
My definition of God. I don't think we're ready for that one, but.
Go ahead on. Let me have it.
Huh?
Go ahead on. Let me have it.
Okay. I don't want to get nobody in trouble.
Okay.
Well, that term.
We don't let them get in trouble.
Huh?
We don't let them get in trouble.
Oh, shoot. So you really put me on the spot on that because you know, I have to be honest with what I know to be truth, even if you want to call it my truth. But this comes from things that I have studied. That word, when you look it up in the etymology, I think it's the etymology. Where did I get it from here? The etymology or the Strong's Concordance. Let's see, there's another one and when you look that word up, it says G-O-D means gada in the Hebrew. In gada means destroyer. Okay?
Okay.
Yeah. And all throughout the Bible and the writings, and they use the term G-O-D, it is talking about that fallen entity. And think about, you got nations of people with different religions, and they all use the term God. Okay, what God? Which God? God who? So, that term, G-O-D, again, when you look it up, it means destroyer. And that describes the naturist character of that entity. You remember there's a passage that says that he comes to steal, kill, and destroy. And that is talking about the G-O-D. And like I said, it, you know, look it up for yourself, research it for yourself. And I'm pretty sure you'll come into some more understanding on what I'm saying here. Now,
okay.
That G-O-D is different from the true living, who I refer to as all Elohim, A-L-O-H-Y-M, not E-L-H-O-M, that's E-L is talking about that fallen entity. A-L is talking about the Creator. So, yeah, all right.
Okay, so, all right. Well, we're getting close. We're getting close. Now, I'm going to deal with this other question, and then we're going to go on down in. It's just a little quick question, you know, brother hanging out on the street, you know, and he just asked you, is robbing banks wrong? How would you answer, yes or no?
It depends. well, it really depends. I kind of hang out in the gray area.
so it
depends on the person, the situation.
How much money we ain't got.
Okay, yeah. Well, hypothetically, yeah, robbing a bank is wrong.
Okay. And so, because I remember one time, well, I remember several times that the bank went up in courthouses and took people houses from them.
Yeah.
So you mean to tell me that robbing the bank is wrong?
And that's what I mean when I said that it depends on the situation. Because I know that, you know, so much stolen, destroyed, you know, just like that entity we were just talking about. And, you know, I use this, you know, you got some people that have worked all of their lives, you know, and then when they retire, they get the what I call the poverty check, that Social Security check. And and then some people... Yeah, and then some people get other extra incentives that go with it. And I've heard people say, I'm not gonna take no handout. I say, what you mean? You don't work all those years. You don't work all your life. You are due that and some. So it's not that you're taking a handout, but they were taking it out your check all the years you worked. That's yours.
Okay.
So,
well, now, have you ever heard of Hermes?
Yeah.
Heard that?
I heard of the Atlantean.
Yeah. So what do you think about that? I mean, we're talking about the Emerald Tablets, and this is some ancient stuff.
Right. I'm still listening to the Emerald Tablets, and I'm still processing things about that, because I would say that the Emerald Tablets and what is it? There's some other books. What are the other? You got the Black Roots book, and what's the other one? I can't think of the name of it, but.
You got to Gilgamesh epic.
The epic of Gilgamesh and Mash and all, and there's still another one. But my take on that is because I understand, you know, because I was one of those people that was a Bible student, and I branched out and studied a whole lot of other stuff as well. And I know there's a passage in that Bible that over in I forgot what chapter it is in the book of Daniel, where Daniel was told to seal the book, to close the book up, and I'm paraphrasing here, and that the book will not be open, the true books won't be open until the end of the fullness of the Gentiles. And so the real books have been closed. Even that canon we call a Bible, there's some true things in there, and then there's some altered things in there, I'll put it like that. And once Daniel was told to seal the book up, we have not had the true book until now, and I think the true books are the Emerald Tablets and the Epic of Gilgamesh and the Black Roots book and what's it, that's the other one, it's on the tip of my tongue. I think that those are the books that are being opened. Now, they've been in existence for a long, long time, but they're just starting to open up. And when I say open up, I don't mean just opening the book and reading the pages as much as I'm saying that those books are opening up and being revealed to us where we can understand it.
Okay. All right. Well, what I want to do at this point here, because the clock is winding down, I have a very, very short plug, and the title of the plug is The Truth About Soul. So I want to run that, then and we'll come back, and then we can elaborate on that and move on back into time or whichever way you want to go. Okay? Hold on a minute. I'll be ready.
Welcome to Open Your Reality. I'm Chad. In this video, I'm going to play an excerpt from my second interview with the renowned Billy Carson. In it, Billy talks in detail about Thoth, who was an actual historical figure who was closer akin to a god than an actual man. Thoth is said to have achieved ascension on Earth 52,000 years ago. He served as the king of Atlantis for thousands of years. He was also among the first to introduce writing to the world. Later on, he found himself in Egypt, in which he ruled a colony there for thousands of years. And he was known as the scribe, and was responsible for writing down the ancient history that we now know today of that fabled land. Thoth was also the builder of the Great Pyramid of Giza. Perhaps his best contribution to the world is the Emerald Tablets, which contains the foundation of the ancient mysteries. Many books have been written on the tablets, including the compendium of the Emerald Tablets authored by Billy Carson himself. Without further delay, here is what Billy had to say about the incredible and legendary Thoth.
I think that he's here a lot more than people even know. I think that he, Thoth also owns Mercury. Now, if you look at some of the data that I pulled down from there, there's anomalies there. Mercury was attributed to him, and it's owned by him. These people own star systems. These people own constellations. These people own planets. And so he does go away from time to time. He also does, he has moved his halls of Amenti. It used to be underneath the Great Pyramid when the Great Pyramid was complete, when it was a complete and functioning stone computer and generator. None of the technology has been removed from it, and the apex has been taken off. The top has been taken off. It's a broken system, and there's no water flowing underneath as for physiostatic electricity. They found the halls underneath the Great Pyramid. They're there. That's in my book. But the halls are empty now. He's moved it somewhere else, maybe off-planet or somewhere else. But the halls is where he has the rejuvenation chambers located, where he would go in there, and he would rejuvenate a body that's aged, and he would take another body, and he would transfer his consciousness into another body. So he says, I walk amongst men, but unlike a man. I think he comes and goes from time to time, walking amongst us here and there, trying to slowly guide and lead the way in certain areas, watching. He says in the Emerald Tablet that he goes to different planets and watches civilizations rise and fall. That takes a long time. According to the ancient Egyptians in their own hieroglyphs, he ruled over the land of Kem for 14,000 years. And that's not even a long period of time compared to some of the Sumerian kings list. And that's located in the Ashmolean Museum in Oxford, England, where some of these people ruled over land over different areas of the land of the world for 28,800 years, 14,400 years. I mean, just all these incredible ranges of years just for ruling. That's not even how long they lived. So these people have immense lifespans, and it looks like the only thing that can take them down is an actual f***er. And even in those cases, according to the ancient Egyptian accounts, even that has been overted sometimes, where they had brought people back to life. It's so important, man, because it really does open up something in the brain. It opens up chambers of enlightenment. It takes you into different tangents and dimensions consciously. Just reading it aloud, the way that the cadence works when you're reading it, it even does something to you physiologically. And it really is really giving you an idea of how to treat yourself, how to treat other people, how to overcome evil, not to fight evil, and because you can't really fight evil. You can only learn how to control it. And so it's one of these things, when you read it, the more and more you read it, more and more you see. And when you begin to do some of the meditations and learn some of the techniques that Thoth teaches in the Emerald Tablets and meditations, you can really achieve some of these amazing things. And one of the ultimate goals in there is to be able to incarnate at will on and in the plane you desire, which is what he claims to be able to do, controlling your incarnation, coming back, in other words, with memories, either when you attain them at birth or at some particular point in age, the memories come flooding back from your previous incarnation. So it's pretty interesting stuff, and I really do believe that it's all about getting people to understand how to seek the light. It's that word, that term, or that phrase is in there over probably 300 times. Seek the light. Go towards the light. Be the light. It's about loving one another, loving yourself, being a kind person, helping others, and it's also about helping your fellow man and with everybody else to obtain another golden age and sustain a golden age. And so it's a real important piece of work. It was written for this time right now that we are in today, for us to actually understand it. It tries to do away with divide and conquer. It tries to warn us about the dark brothers. That's the oligarchs that run the planet. He talks about it way back then and tells us we have to be aware of these people. We have to overcome the darkness that they're trying to dispel on us, and we have to, you know, dispel that darkness with light. If you're in a room full of darkness and you turn on a tiny, tiny little pinprick of light from a phone or from a light pen, the darkness will flee. But there's no room full of light that a little tiny pinprick of darkness can come and make the light flee. So we have to be the light. We have to shed the light. You can't get rid of darkness because it always will exist, because you have yin and yang. But we can seek the light, be the light, and we can spread this light and become a much more better enlightened civilization on this planet. And we can reduce significantly the amount of darkness that we're allowing to rule and run over us right now. Pretty interesting that when you look into these emerald tablets and you start reading them, you find out how powerful the information is in these tablets, and that they're talking about different levels of advanced technology that we just don't have today. We just don't have it. We're not even close. Now, we're getting close, but some of the stuff that these people were capable of doing is just mind-blowing. It's boggling. It's mind-boggling, okay? Extending lifespans for centuries, for eons, actual eons. Some of these people have lived for multiple thousands of years, all right, which is incredible. Thoth himself lived for thousands and thousands of years. Not a couple of hundred years, not a few hundred, thousands. Now, according to Thoth, only free-thinking individuals using their own conscious thought can be capable of rising to a higher level of consciousness. Say that again. According to Thoth, only free-thinking individuals using their own conscious thoughts can be capable of rising to a higher level of consciousness. And what Thoth is saying is, in order for you guys to rise to the higher level, you got to change the way you think. You got to change the way you see the world. You got to change the way you see yourself. And only a free thinker breaking the bondage of the normalized mainstream thinking, for example, a person that sees outside of that and is able to see around and maneuver through that, only that person that can make its own mind up and its own decisions based on its own conscious thought and not download the programming code that's given to us by the teachers in the school, the mainstream media on TV, on the news, and everything else, right? The pastor at the church and all this other stuff, what your parents feed your brain 24/7 that they've been handed down from millennia to millennia. Only the person that can break through that and actually see it for what it is and think for themselves, ask questions for themselves, are the ones that can achieve a higher level of consciousness.
Wow, you heard what Billy just said, but this is only scratching the surface of what the Emerald Tablets are all about. They're truly one of the most remarkable pieces of writing ever found. If you want me to make a video expounding on the tablets, let me know in the comments section, and I'll do it. I appreciate everyone. Oh,
the first people on the land of the Americas and the illusion of time. Now I'm gonna bring it back in, and we only have 54 minutes left, and we're gonna roll on out to the close of the broadcast. Joi, you still with me?
Yes, I'm here.
Okay, let's go back to the vibrational frequency and what we should be using. Because and the reason I want to do that is because I was sitting up here the other day. They had a European artist, a Caucasian gentleman. I don't call his name and stuff. But he was classified by them as a singer. And I had never really taken the time out of my life to just sit down and listen to him sing to see whether or not he could sing. Because I know what singing is, and I know how to sing. But he messed around and made the statement that they said they were going to put me in the Smithsonian Institute. And I'm like, what? Why? Because I listened to you sing. I'm not saying that you couldn't sing. I'm not saying it. I personally didn't feel nothing when you were singing.
Okay.
But what I want to do at this point right here, and it's only going to take a little couple of minutes, and then we'll be right back, is I want to look at what I consider, and this is just my personal opinion, what I consider singing, and whether or not this should not only be put in the Smithsonian Institute, but in the Hall of Fame when it comes to singing. Hold on a minute.
Somebody to hold my hand, somebody to love me and understand. I want a woman,
woman.
I want a lover,
a lover.
I want a friend,
a woman, a lover, a friend.
I want somebody my love. Just loving is something I've got plenty of. I want a woman,
woman.
I want a lover,
lover.
I want a friend.
You still with me?
Yes.
Did you, and I'm not talking about the vibrational frequency at this point. I'm talking about the actual singing. Now, what has been the most extraordinary thing that I have seen all my life, ever since I came in the world, in the United States of America, they've been pointing at people who they say could sing, and I've been looking at this in total astonishment because it didn't never move me toward nothing that they could ever classify as singing and I couldn't understand what is going on. I said, there's something going on. I don't know what it is. I know singing when I hear it, and I know singing when I see it. But they tell me that, well, he sold 46 million albums, and I'm not asking to who, I'm asking how, why, what, what is this? So I've come to the conclusion, now we have vibrational frequency. I think that the natural peoples of the Americas and Africa and everywhere else we at is on a different vibrational frequency than our Europeans and other people who are not us. What do you think about that?
Yeah, that's true. Wow, thundering over here, boy. Yeah, that is true, and that is because we are. Gosh, I don't want to go get in there too deep, and you get me in trouble. But
take time.
I'll just say this: we are a different people. There is different species, I would call it, and different groups of people are different, even though they have, tried to make it seem like we're all the same. We all bleed red blood, which is true, and we're all the same, but that is not true. I'll give an example, and I don't want to go too deep and get in no trouble, but say, for instance, when a person, when a dead body is found, and there's nothing but bones. I used to always ask the question, how do they know that, and they'll tell you with those bones, whether it was Caucasian or African or black person, whatever, they could tell you when there's nothing but bones. And so I'm trying to figure out, how do they know what that person's, for lack of a better term, race is? And I learned that, in the back of our head, below the occipital bone, there are veins and bones that run down the back of the below the occipital bone. I understand that we, as I would call Negroid, we have 8 of those bones. Those other people only have 4. They only have 4.
Okay.
Our teeth are pretty much moved somewhat on the very top. Those other nations of people, they have ridges because they, are designed to eat that red meat. And there's other things that tell the difference, but I'm not going to go into this because you're going to get me in trouble. But
I don't want to get you in trouble now. You take your time.
Our vibration is different because we are different. We are not the same people, if you want to call it that. Then there's a difference in that term, human or human.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Well, now, I went in the grocery store one time, and it was out on the south side, and I went in there. I was gonna pick up a couple items and carry it home and cook me something to eat. But there was a big white guy, stand there. He had some chocolate sausage and stuff that he had and fixed up and had a special recipe on it. And when I bent the corner, he said, "You want a piece?" I said, "What is it?" He said, "It's cold." Mm-hmm. I said, no.
What did he say it is?
That. He said, "Well, pork sausage." I said, no, I'm half pound of some. Man, it's good. This is the best sausage you ever ate. I said, but I don't eat no pork. Well, why not? I said, well, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad told us not to eat it.
Mm-hmm.
The hell with Muhammad. I got good corn here. Here, put it in your hands and stuff. And I was looking at him. I said, man, I was tired, man. You was having the TV up. Not still. Anyway, I took it and put it in my hands and said, "I want you to eat it right now." I said, "I ain't eating it right now." And I walked around the corner when I got outside, throw it away. But he was going to try to force me to eat something that I don't already told him that I don't want.
Mm-hmm.
I was quite disturbed by that. But anyway,
hello?
I'm here.
Oh, okay. Go ahead. What were you saying? That you say that disturbed you.
Yeah, I was kind of disturbed by that because I thought he was wrong for trying to force me to eat something that I didn't want to eat. Regardless of what I said, for my reason that I didn't want to eat. And to me, the vibrational frequency up in there was a little bit different. I didn't want to disturb the peas. I didn't want to start taking whole counters, throwing down on top of them and throwing them through a plate glass and all that. I didn't want to do no more of that.
Yeah, well, you know, I've learned that people generally feel like what they do, everybody do. That's just like you got some people say that smoke cigarettes, and people come around that they don't know, and they may try to get a cigarette from you or offer you a cigarette. People that do a whole lot of get down, use profanity, they think everybody get down profanity like that. So people project themselves on others. And then we live in a society where society has been forcing things on us. Sometimes we don't even know what they're doing. Example, I know I went to the hospital. They said my blood sugar was high. And it was high because I had to get some spurgeon. And they wanted to give me that metformin or whatever they give you. And I said, okay, I'm going to let them put that metformin in until I can get my blood sugar at a certain level. But at the same time, I was very hesitant because I didn't know that they haven't changed much on what they how they formulate that medication for blood sugar. They use the substances from the pancreas of a monkey, a pig, or it was one more animal. And so, you know, I reconfirmed with the doctor while I was there and asked them. They said yes. And I'm saying, well, why would I agree to you putting pig in me when I don't even eat pig? But they claim that they use those animals because their pancreas is very similar to ours. I say, but we're still not the same. So many things are being forced on us, and we're not even aware. We just sit up and whatever they say, we take it, not knowing.
Well, I think we got a lot of people out there going along with that stuff. It appears that we have a caller with his hands raised and stuff, and we're down to 39 minutes, so I'm going to open up the phone line. Area code 312, if you have a question for our guest, Pearls of Joi. Go ahead and ask your question. 312, you on the line.
Good afternoon, rather good evening to you and your guest, Tarhaka.
Brother Yoel, what's going on? Yo, this is Brother Yoel out of Chicago, the underground bookstore.
Oh, okay. Okay. Hey, brother, how are you?
I'm good. How are you?
Good.
Interesting subject, and I'd like to know, one, what made you go into this area of with your book with respect to time, or the study that you ventured into? What caused you to go into detail the research and write something about it?
As I mentioned, you know, I have been a Bible student for many years, and I can remember one of the first lessons that I taught in a particular church. It was in relation to time, and what the best way that I can explain it, it was something that was basically put in my mind. I didn't go looking for this. I wasn't trying to do this, and it just came to me. And I can remember one night, I just woke up in the middle of the night, and I asked the question about, I think I asked the question about days, how many days is in a week? And I heard the number 9. And so from that point, I started researching and studying about those things. You are, I'm pretty sure you all are familiar with, I think this brother name is I can't think of his whole name, but I have a quote, but I don't have it in front of me now. I can tell you where he appeared on the Philippe Shock show, and even he said that he has a calendar that consists of 36 days, and he quoted, and I can tell you the increment of where he said it, but he basically said that everybody knew that there were 9 days in a week and not 7. As a matter of fact, the Julian calendar had 8 days in it, and at one time we had a 3-day weekend instead of a so-called 2-day weekend, and on the 9-day count of days, on the 7th day, as I understand it and what I've seen in my studies, the 7th day is the day that we rest. And they took, they used that scenario from the Bible where it says that the Creator created everything in 6 days, and on the 7th day he rested. And they accounted that as just 1 day of rest. But it was actually 3 days of rest, the 7th, the 8th, and the 9th, because the 7th day is the day for you to just chill and relax and prepare. And then on the 8th day, it's like concentration, and then on the 9th day is a completion. Like I was saying, the title of this, the number 9, is Universal Perfection and Completion. And in that case, and I'll make this point, all the numbers are perfect and complete in their own essence. Say, for instance, when a mother carries a baby, and there's 3 trimesters, the first trimester, the first, second, and third month, each one of those months are is doing something in that particular process. And in that third month, it ends that particular process. So it is perfect and complete. Then it picks up again at the number 4, 4 through 6, which is the second trimester. Then it goes on through 7 through 9, which is a third trimester. And all of those trimesters, each one of those numbers are perfect and complete in what they are doing. So the 9, like I said, it is universal. And I don't know, did I answer your question? That's pretty much, a synopsis of how I came to this. And like I said, it wasn't something that I was trying to do. I wasn't trying to do this, but I have been laboring over this thing since probably for about 4 years now.
So you say you are a Bible student. That means you're a Christian?
No, I used to be a Christian.
Okay. So you taught in the church, but you're no longer there.
Yes. During
right?
that time, no. Yes. During that time, I was called out of the church.
What made you? What called you out?
Well, I would say the Most High. The Most High. You know, the Most High called me out of the church. You know, and I studied. I studied for 7 years. Basically, just me and the Creator. And then I moved on from there because I felt like I had went as far as I could go with the resources that I was using. And then I ended up going to I studied at House of Israel, which is in Charlotte, North Carolina, and I did a 4-year study there in Hebrew mm-hmm. roots. I'm not affiliated with any religion. But I am a child and a believer of the Creator of the universe.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Now, what was the name of your book again?
The Gift of Law is the Gift of Love.
And
the subtitle,
I like
Longer Under the Law. Huh?
I'd like to get some for the store, so can I contact you to get some or what? Wholesale for the store?
Let me check Amazon because they were on Amazon. I don't think I have many copies with me. But let me check Amazon, and I'm sure Tarhaka can contact you.
Of course.
Yeah, I'll give you her number, and you can you can contact her so y'all can straighten that out. I'll send it to you in a email so you'll have it.
Okay. So you how long has the book been out?
I published that book in 2014.
I can't mm-hmm. seem to find it on Amazon.
I got it. I got it right here in my hand.
Okay, your name is Shirley?
Yes. But I go by Joy,
okay.
But Shirley is my birth name.
Okay. Now I got it. I know he probably heard him call you Joy, but
yes,
I'm looking at a Shirley here, Rodall.
Rodall.
Okay, I got it, yeah. Yeah, but no, they don't wholesale, so yeah, I would have to talk to you.
Okay.
And you
it says back in the back cover, it says made in the United States of America, Charleston, South Carolina, 23rd of March 2016. So I think that's when they got themselves together to start putting it out. But I got it right here in my hand.
Yeah, I don't know if I have any more copies, yeah.
I'll talk more with you on that when I talk to you then. Okay.
Okay. All right.
Okay. Great. All right. Good subject. I'm glad you that opens up some things for you. And that is a good aspect of things. I've always told people that, actually, I end up telling a lot of Christians about this first of the year. And when January come around, they'd be saying to me, Happy New Year, and I always have to tell them this is not the new year yet, you know.
Right.
So, and I say, well, let's tell them that if you want to know the new year, go look at in your Bible, and it says the month of Abib.
Right.
And then they go look and they find it, and some of those who look anyway, they find it, and they find that I was right about what I said. You know, I said the new year starts with new life. You know,
that's right.
Nothing is new in the dead of winter.
That's
you know?
Right. That's,
so
right. That's right.
So I understand what you're saying there. And it's all about, to me, over the years, I found that, see, we lose our power when we lose our being in tune with the Creator and creation.
Sure, nature,
okay?
Right.
The more you can get you out of tune or out of
mm-hmm.
harmony with Creator
mm-hmm.
and creation, then you lose your power. You
that's
know?
Right. That's right. Yeah, because, you know, as I mentioned that our food is electric, magnetic, electric, and because we are magnetic electricity, and we have to charge up, and we charge up from the things that we're putting in, and even, you know, something that I took on probably about a year or more ago, and that is grounding, you know, going outside, walking barefooted in the grass, in the dirt, you know, because what that does, it recharges us. We have to be grounded. Like when you're building a house and you're doing electricity, you have to put a grounding wire down in the ground next to that house. And that's what connects to the electric current that's already in the earth. And we have to do the same thing.
Also in all electronic devices, they have to have a ground.
That's right.
So that's true. And as a shorty, I know we used to, I'm from Mississippi, so we used to always even race on gravel road barefoot.
Okay, well,
anyway,
thank you for calling
I've
in.
I've enjoyed your presentation.
Thank you.
All right, well, now you
know, Brother Joel, what we discuss tonight, that's all the way off the Richter scale.
What's that?
I say, what we've been discussing tonight is all the way off the Richter scale.
Oh, really?
We got a whole lot of new information that's coming out and stuff, and we got to put it out here. And we don't have no choice, especially as a nation of people, in the trouble that we in, man. You got, you know, just like I said earlier, you got sharks and whales attacking boats in the Atlantic, and you got a coral reef bleaching out down here in Florida, and then you got otters and seals attacking surf boaters. We in trouble, man. Somebody got to do something.
Some things is going out of balance because nature is trying to put things in balance. But we're going to be all right. We are going to be all right.
All right. Well, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to say if you got a question for our guest, all you got to do is press 1 on your phone. I'll open up your phone line and you can ask our guest a question. Okay? There's one on the phone because we got 26 minutes left. Now's your time. Press one on the phone if you got a question, and we open up the phone lines so you can get in. Y'all hold on a minute. We'll be right back.
Around, I will fight for his right. I'll be there no matter where his troubles lie. is there for me. Nothing feels as good as a brother's loyalty. Talking about family, talking about what my brother means to me. If my brother's in trouble, I will always help him out. If my brother's in trouble, I will turn the world around. I will fight for his house. I'll be there no matter where the troubles lie. If my brother's in trouble, so am I. If my brother's in trouble, so am I. Yeah, yeah, yeah. I'll be right there to help you. Don't be such a pain, I'll pull you through. Oh,
everybody. We're back. Our special guest is Joi, Pearls of Joi. We're dealing with the first peoples on the land of the Americas and the illusion of time. I'm going to bring her back in, and then we will continue, okay? Still with me, Joi?
Oh, yeah. Well, I'm sorry. What did you say?
I said, I was just asking if you were still with me.
Oh, yeah, yeah, I thought I said, yeah, yes, I'm still here.
Okay. Now, in ancient times, because I feel like you might could do a little something with this. Ancient giants on the lands of the Americas and the mound building. What you got?
Well, yes, there were giants in the land, and the Nephilim, the children of the children that came down and made it with the sons of the Most High, and the children that they had, they were giants. And so, yeah, there's many different a sect of giants. Yes, those giants, they found giant graves right here in America. And that would take me to basically say, America is Egypt. And all of those things that took place.
Oh. Wait a minute now, I ain't saying anything wrong, but I don't think we were ready for that. I was going to do that on two more broadcasts.
Okay, all
now.
Right. Okay. So I'll just say this. Basically, all the things that are narrated in that Bible, it actually took place right here in this land. And the stories have been misconstrued. There were lots of monuments and different artifacts and everything that the Vatican, the Smithsonian, the Mormons, they got our artifacts, and all of the monumental images. The buildings, the pyramids and all of that, they destroyed most of them that were here. And they went over in so-called Egypt, and that's a whole nother story. They went over in Egypt and they made replicas of what was already here. to try to displace the truth about what the where the true old world is. This is the old world. So, but anyway, yeah, giants and yeah, all of that stuff existed. I actually had some maps showing you the giants up under the ground.
Okay. Well, mm-hmm. Let me go back over here to area code 312. Open that back up again. 312, you're back on the air.
No, this is it's still me.
I know.
Yeah.
Give me some on these
okay.
Giants, man.
You know what I heard? I heard that tape you played, and the brother was saying something about Thorpe died, till he died. I'd like to know where he got that information from, because all the information and research I've done says that one of the attributes of Thorpe was he was the Lord of Time, keeper of the Akashic records, supposedly, or you know, so or people, you know, so in the I'd like to know how he comes to the conclusion that he died when, if you're the Lord of Time, you can't die on the job. You report everything.
Right. So, now he also. Yeah,
I like you put that one.
Yeah. Now, I didn't know. Yeah. I didn't know he died, but I know he thought also reincarnated.
Okay.
Well, you came down
now. Right. Yeah. But you know, it's you know, I have some information on it, but I'm just gonna be silent right now.
No, wait a minute.
I know some things about Thoth, because from what I understand, if I got it right, Thoth was also the same as Tahuti, and
right.
What was there? So
Hermes.
And also Hermes, Trimis, Hermes, Trismegistus too. Uh-huh.
Okay. Yeah. So you know, there I have, you know, some information. But I don't want to, put it out there and not know enough to you know, put the put the cap on it and close it up.
Well, Brother Uel, can I make a suggestion?
Go ahead, brother.
I know you own a bookstore, but what I might recommend is you come over here where I'm at and get in my library. You might a lot of questions. Might could be answered, because how are you going to die when you are a spirit, you are a spiritual being having a human experience? How are you going you fly out of one coconut into another coconut? So how you going to die? And then I already told you, because I looked at the immortality. And you say, don't correct me on the numbers, but 216 times down through life coming in and out. So, and even when you die, if you go down in the numerology section, it tells you that when y'all are going to bury somebody in the ground and y'all come into the funeral and all that, the person that you're burying is either standing at the head of the casket or the foot of the casket. And they don't get upset until they see you getting upset. So they ain't going nowhere. They just slip out of the imaginary illusion of time, and they'll be back if they decide they want to come back. You know what I heard one time? I heard a little white boy. He came back.
Caucasian.
And he told his daddy, he said, I always been here. And daddy said to him, and I seen you and mommy in Hawaii before I came. Before he was born.
And you know what? I'll share this right quick. I did this, I don't know, I guess you would call it an experiment under the suggestion of someone. They suggested that, you know, we take a piece of paper and write on the paper, who am I, how long have I been here, and what is my purpose for being here? And, you know, we're supposed to read it for 30 days straight. And we were told that you will get your answer, and if they lie to you, you will know it. And so I did it for 30 days, and then after that, I think I buried it. And in the midst of all of that, I was hearing, when I asked the question, I think last time I asked that question, how long have I been here? You know what I heard?
What's that?
Eternity.
Mm-hmm.
So based on what I understand about coming back, reincarnation, it's like I've been here from the beginning, and I've gone and came back many times because it said I had been here for eternity.
Yeah.
So
what having just said what you did, and I think that the talker, you was alluding to that same thing, you can't be destroyed. You know, it's like energy can't be destroyed, and that's energy. That energy inside body, that you know, it can't be destroyed. So you never die. You transform, but there's no death. But so going back to what that brother said, I've been hearing him talk a lot lately, but like as if he's the top authority on what he talks about, but it's only to people who don't know a little bit of something as well, you know. Yeah. And I think that he's not exactly the guru that they trying to make him out to be, but he speaks as if he is. And to those people who don't know nothing, he sounds like he is, you know, to them. So I'd like to have him to answer that question, but he ain't here, so he can't answer that question.
Do you listen to him?
No, I've only heard him speak briefly a few times. That's it, and people have asked me about him, but I pick up some few things that doesn't quite line up with what I've already know. And but I just leave it there, because I don't have him to ask that. And I've tried to get his book, but it's very difficult to get in touch with him, and he don't respond. So
are you talking about the person that was talking about thoughts, Billy Carson?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Well, I get the text from him at least two or three times out in a day, because he's advertising. His upcoming videos that he's going to be broadcasting. I'm trying to think if I can get that information. But like you, I emailed him
at least three times, and they only get an automated response comes back to me and tells me that somebody's going to get in touch with me, but nobody never did.
Nobody has, yeah. So
I was trying to get the book for my customers that wanted the book as well. I think it's kind of pricey, too much, really.
Well, I know that he's doing a lot. They're getting ready to do an event.
I started this now around the end of last year, trying to contact this guy. I think it's in November, December last year, and all the way up until about March, I think I stopped trying after that. I'm like.
Okay. So, do you? I know you watch YouTube. Have you ever listened to his teachings on YouTube?
Yes, like I said, briefly, but I didn't. Not a long period of time. I've never really went through a full one and whatnot. So, sometimes the thought of him not getting back to me getting my way too. So I said, forget about it.
Yeah. I understand, because like I said, you know, I follow him, and I'm kind of up on, you know, what he's doing. And I know with some of these platforms out here, sometimes they themselves, maybe with one or two other people, are the only ones that's doing the work. And I know he is traveling. I know of one day he caught a plane, three different planes, going one to California, one to Chicago, and one to Florida. And that's kind of like his day, you know, many times throughout the week. So I don't know. I'll see if I can find something to give to you.
Well, we can talk about that when I call you then.
Okay. All right. That's cool.
Great.
All right, y'all. Now, we're down to 8 hours. I mean, 8 minutes and 42 seconds. Brother Yoel, tell us how to get a hold to you, man, and you call in information on how to get a hold of your books, where you at, man, how do we get to you, man?
Okay, well, you know, again, Underground Bookstore in Chicago, South Side of Chicago, 1727 East 87th Street. Telephone number 773-768-8869. 773-768-8869. Or you can email us at undergroundbookstore1@gmail.com. Okay?
Okay.
And we specialize in kind of finding them hard to get books and whatnot, you know?
Okay.
That's what we really specialize in.
Okay.
All right, Joy, how you want folks to get a hold of you and get your books and let me have how you want the nation to connect to you.
How okay. As of this right now, I don't have any separate way to contact me, you know, except through my personal. And, of course, I would like to do it separate from that. In the meantime, I am going to contact Amazon, and, again, I'll get with you to see which route I can go with them on the book and some other things I'm doing. Maybe if we do another a setting like this or whatever, I'll have it all together then.
Okay. Well, we're going down, Brother Yoel, you got anything else you want to say before I shut this thing down, man?
Well, not really, but these are some interesting times, and it's a lot of information coming out right now, and we ain't through yet, so if everything is food for thought and grounds for further investigation right now, because we just at the doorway of this new age, supposedly, that's coming in right now, so... I'm sure there's a lot more information that's going to be surfacing and coming out right now. Okay?
Of course.
Okay.
Yes, okay.
All right, Joy, you have anything else you want to say? My special guest.
Thank you for calling in and everybody that's out there. And I really appreciate
you.
It. And I just want to say maybe on another go-round, I do want to get more into the clock time that I was talking about, the fact that clock time is not the creator's time. Clock time is the instrument created by the foreigners to control time. And
right.
I will be going into doing a synopsis on the clock and the fact that the terms, hours, minutes, and seconds have been manipulated. The hours, moment, the term moment was changed to hours, and the terms minutes was changed to seconds. And I, you know, have information to back that up and prove that. But those are the methods that they use to create that clock. Which
now, is
not
all
the same vibration. No. Like I said, no. That's not in the book. That's this is this information that I had been working on, as I told you, for about 4 years on this time. I was calling it time number 9, universal perfection and completion, but I'm just calling it number 9, universal perfection and completion. But no, it's not in that book.
Okay. Okay. All righty.
Yep.
Thank you very
much. All right, thank you.
All right, everybody, I certainly appreciate y'all being on here, man. And Joi, I'm finna close y'all mics out and close this here thing down. And I'm just glad I dodged thunder and lightning tonight. Y'all have a nice night. We'll be right back.